This is TWiT.
Yeah. So, hey, Tariq, now that you're back.
Yes.
Earn your stripes, do a little heavy lifting, and hey, give us, we had another press conference with NASA just a couple days ago on Starliner, so they could spend another 40 minutes not telling us what's going on. So what did they say?
Well, I'm going to put it in perspective. In the space of the 8-day mission of NASA's Starliner, I have gone to Singapore, come back from Singapore, gone to Alaska, and come back from Alaska over the course of 2 months. So, so with this latest update, this week, NASA has said that they haven't made a decision yet. That was their big news. They opened by saying they had no big announcements to make. However, they said that they may make a decision as early as the end of the next week. So hopefully by the time you and I meet again for This Week in Space, we can say definitively when these astronauts, Butch Wilmore and Sonny Williams, will return to Earth, and if it will be on Starliner or if it will be on a SpaceX Dragon, which seems very likely because they keep saying that they don't really like have a risk analysis in hand, you know, with these thruster issues they've been doing. That was really surprising this week, where again, it was just NASA managers. There was no one from Boeing on the call.
Yeah, that was weird. Yeah.
They did say that they really couldn't pin down like the specific risk of coming back on Starliner. They do say that it's fine for the astronauts to use Starliner to come to Earth if there's like a emergency, like a meteor hits the space station or something like that, they can come home. But they don't want to say that for like normal, which is really strange to me at this point in time. So it's just very confusing. But it's clear that actually one of our writers, Josh Dinner, asked NASA if this thruster issue is a fatal flaw, quote unquote, for Starliner or not. And it wasn't clear if NASA is looking at it that way or not, but clearly it's something that they have to just truly get their minds around. And they really just, they weren't ready to make a final call. Ken Bowersox did say that they need to make an announcement or a decision at the end of their next flight readiness review meeting, the next FRR. That could be as early as next week or as we're recording this. It could be a little bit after, you know, like the very early in the week prior, because they have to get ready. Like, are they going to have Butch and Sonny make some makeshift seats on the Crew 8 Dragon and come down with them? Are they going to leave two astronauts off of the Crew 9 launching in late September and then have them stay up there until February and then come back with that crew? Do they come back on Starliner, you know, sometime in September? Those are decisions that require a lot of preparation either way that they go to get ready, because there's a lot of moving parts right now. You have a new crew waiting to fly to the space station on a Russian Soyuz. You have the Crew 9 mission in late September. You have this cargo mission that is just arriving this weekend as we're recording it from Russia, and then another SpaceX one in the wings that's been delayed. So a lot of moving parts. But very much a punt to next week in terms of a decision.
Yeah, a lot of moving parts with a lot of question marks associated, and there's a lot to unpack here, but I think we'll just have to wait till next time. But yes, it's going to be, you know, if SpaceX does end up, you know that the popular media is going to pick it up with the storyline of rescue, you know, we're going to rescue these astronauts. It's just such another black eye for Boeing, and I would give anything, my pin feathers, to be a fly on the wall in the senior C-suite conference room in Chicago, just to find out, not to gloat or anything, but just to find out what kind of conversation you can have after all the issues in civil aviation, and now this. You know, I guess if I was the PR hack in the room, I'd be, okay, like Gene Kranz said in Apollo 13, so what have we got on the spacecraft that's good? You know, what can we gloat about for a minute? I mean, are we making catalytic converters for gasoline cars or something? All right, but we have to move along. So from that to a real upbeat, kind of a cool new thing.
Yeah.
Fram 2 flight on SpaceX. Now, the Fram was the ship that Admonson sailed down to the South Pole, famously, from which he departed to beat Scott to the South Pole, among other things. And the Fram, which I visited a couple years ago, was very ingeniously devised. Unlike the British ships and others that went down to the Antarctic, this one was shaped like a bowl. So while it wasn't very seaworthy, when the ice froze in, it just popped up and sat there until the ice melted. So ingenious. So tell us what the Fram 2 spaceflight is.
Yeah, so this is very exciting. We found out that by the end of this year, SpaceX will be flying another private mission. As you mentioned, it's called Fram 2. And this will be a historic flight in and of itself. It's going to be the first private human space flight around Earth's poles. Mm-hmm. And they're going to launch by like this year, which is crazy. Usually, like, you get a mission, and then there's like a full year of development and lead up to it, and then you get it like we saw with Inspiration 4. And by the way, that mission funded by Jared Isaacman paved the way for Polaris Dawn, which was going to do the first private spacewalk on a SpaceX Dragon this month as we're recording this. So it's just a couple weeks away. So they're going to follow up that historic spacewalk with this historic polar flight. This mission is financed by a cryptocurrency speculator and billionaire, Chun Wang, I believe I pronounced that correctly. And they called him a crypto magnet over at CNBC, where we got the story. And it is named after this 19th century Fram mission to the poles. And he's bringing three other Arctic specialists with him. I apologize if I get these names wrong, because I've never heard them out loud. But you have Janica Mikkelsen, who is a 38-year-old Norwegian filmmaker. You have Eric Phillips, a 62-year-old Australian explorer and guide. And Rabia, and I think it's Roger? Roji, a 28-year-old German researcher. So you've got these two men, these two women who will be flying on this mission. They're going to have that cupola bubble on the nose, as they did with Inspiration 4, so they can observe the poles with the tail. And so it'll be very interesting. And Wang, by the way, is 42 years old. That's younger than I am. Wow. From Tianjin, China, but he is in the Malta now, where he lives as crypto lifestyle. But I mean, it seems like it's going to be a really interesting and different mission, which is exciting for these private missions, because they all are doing different kind of tailored things, which is instead of just like going to the space station and then putzing around in zero G for a bit, which is what we've seen with a few other ones. So very exciting.
Is that a technical NASA term? This is the putzing budget for this mission.
If I'm going to pay billions of dollars to go to space, I just want to putz around. I'm going to kick off my shoes, have those little sock booty slipper things on, and just look out the window and sip my space coffee. That's what I'm going to do, right? Okay. Something something for the good of mankind, you know, for tax purposes. But
I'm drinking civet cat coffee for all mankind.
That's right.
All right, now let's get to the really important story here, because we know that space.com never succumbs to clickbait or anything. But saw a headline, it's the super moon, blue moon, worm dragon, maggot moon, or something like that.
Pushing
out, because it's important to know these things.
I completely forgot about that. I would have brought that up. Yeah, no, there is a super moon, blue moon coming up on August 19th as we're recording this. It is one of the weird ones, because this is a bit of egg on my face. We had a story last year that said that the August super blue moon of that year was the last one until 2037 or whatever.
Oops.
It was. I know. But it turns out that was the last two full moons in one calendar month. Blue moon until 2037, and that this blue moon is the second and original definition of the blue moon, which is the third full moon in a four full moon season. It's very technical, but we're in the summer season. This is the third full moon of four full moons in the season. You know, normally there's three, because there's 3 months to a quarter out of 12, and so that's this one. And I think the next one of this, you know, super blue caliber comes in like 2033 or something, according to our columnist. But, you know, it's going to be a really good time for everyone to get out this weekend as we're recording it. Look at the moon, because it's going to look extra full, or it's going to look full a day before, a day after. So you've got like Sunday, Monday, Tuesday to enjoy the splendor of the moon. And what is it? It's the sturgeon moon. I learned that's the largest fish in the United States. I didn't know that.
Yeah, and they're ugly too.
Yeah. It is an American fish. I guess we
right. Hey, who are you calling ugly, mister? Tariq, is there a person somewhere that you or NASA or somebody pays to sit and figure out, you know, okay, this is the 357th and a half double blue ice cream something or another moon for this century, but it's important because this is the one where the groundhog pops up and sees his shadow in the moon or something.
No,
Who tracks these things?
So I always default to like NASA and Farmer's Almanac. However, I would be loath. I would be remiss if I did not mention that the whole supermoon phenomena, as it is now, became ultra popularized in 2010 because of an astrologer that put like a big thing out there, and it's like, oh, it's a supermoon, it's the big thing. You know, there should only be one supermoon. There's one largest full moon of the year. There can only be one. Right, like in Highlander, but because they can only be one closest. But what's happened is that definition, since this ultra popularizing in 2010, it really grabbed on to the public. They got really excited about it, and so NASA now puts the moniker onto any full moon that is within like a day or two of perigee, the point in the lunar orbit when it's closest to Earth, and NASA will call it a supermoon. And if you use that NASA kind of loose definition, this coming supermoon is the first of four consecutive supermoons in a series for the rest of the year, and that's kind of how I approach it. It is a bit kitschy. It is a fun way to celebrate the moon. In fact, September is, I think, International Observe the Moon Month, or it might be in October. I have to double check. So just a way to get excited. But I default to NASA and Farmer's Almanac.
Okay, well, Farmer's Almanac. It sounded like you said Farmer's Omelet. Got it.
Hey, if you enjoyed this clip, be sure to check out This Week in Space. You can find us on your favorite podcast app, or see the link in the description below. See you there.